We have the documents. Let's go to the boat. I'll show you some really beautiful places. Absolutely incredible. We're going to visit the archipelago of the Maddalena. Follow me. We're at the start of a beautiful day that promises to be quite warm, and we've just arrived at Marina Cala de Sarde, the greenest marina in Italy, property of the NSS Yachting Group. We're here to shoot an installment of our Sailing Directions videos series. We'll take two boats from the NSS charter fleet and sail for a couple of hours north of here to show you one of the most beautiful places in Italy, the Maddalena Archipelago. We'll visit beautiful bays, pristine beaches, great harbors, and also show you things like the winds and possible dangers. And finally, we'll take you ashore to see the things you can visit on land. So follow me. It'll be quite an adventure.
Sarà una bella avventura.
We're on the eastern side of the island of Caprera. We chose this side for our first stop because today there's a strong westerly wind. They're 20, 22 knots with gusts of 24, 25 knots. But as you see, in this bay, which is called Cala Portesi, the sea continues to be perfectly flat. On the eastern side of the island, we've already been to two bays, Cala Cotticchio and Cala Brigantina, that Simona will now tell us about. And then we'll talk about Cala Portesi, where we are right now. Simona, go ahead.
Okay, let's start with Cala Cotticchio. It is located on the northeastern side of the island of Caprera, a beautiful bay nicknamed Tahiti Beach because the colour of the water is a fantastic emerald due to the white sand. All three bays are mostly sandy, with a few patches of seaweed. Cala Cotticchio is protected from the west to the southeast. However, be careful. Only go there on good weather days, which is not what we have today. Because although no waves come in there, the wind can get funneled through the mountains and turn the boats around up to 100 degrees. So you would need lots of room around you to stay at anchor. But in that bay, there is seldom much room.
Consider that in the summer there are really a lot of boats here. Now we're in June. It's the perfect time to come to the archipelago. As you see, there are very few boats. But between July and August, the boating density here is really high. Now, shall we talk about Cala Brigantino?
Yes, Cala Brigantino is located in the center of the eastern side of the island of Caprera. It's a nice and pretty bay, however, very small. It has room for three or four boats, but no more. It is a small fjord, a small cove, so the more you enter, the more protected you will be. As a shelter, it is protected from the winds from the north to the south. As for the depth of the seabed, it is very shallow, 2.5 meters to 3 meters, and 8 meters just outside the bay. So be careful about how many boats there are. If possible, it's better to have a line ashore to avoid turning.
Finally, we've arrived here at Cala Portesi. Cala Portesi, as you can see, is a very large bay, with several beaches and also a second bay. Back there, a bit hidden where you can be more secluded. On the beach that's on my right, there's also a very nice cafe, ideal for a pleasant break ashore. Simona, would you give us the nautical features of this roadstead?
Yes, Cala Portesi is very well sheltered from the west. So with a strong wind from the northwest or the west, it is the only bay I would recommend for the night, of the three that we've seen on the eastern side of Caprera, without problems. It is sheltered from the northwest all the way round to the southeast and has a depth of about 3 meters inside the bay and a little bit more outside, where it is between 6 and 8 meters deep. It has a sandy bottom here too, with a few patches of seaweed, so pick your sand patch to drop anchor. In addition to being sheltered, you have two anchoring options. This is the small bay that Maurizio mentioned before. Should the first bay be full, you can anchor here as well. Or you can choose one of the dozen or so maritime buoys.
The buoys are free, quote-unquote. Why quotes? Because to enter the park, you have to buy a ticket, and you pay for it with the Italian app called
Pagopa.
Papoga, perfect. However, if you haven't had the time or don't want to rack your brains figuring out how to do it, you can safely arrive at the park and wait for a park raft and buy your ticket, if and when it comes. When it does arrive, you can get the ticket directly with them with a minimal surcharge. Charter boats, most charter boats, such as all NSS charter boats, have this ticket already included in the charter price. The charter company pays it, so you don't have to pay anything at all. You come here and you have your buoys for free. Having said that, I would go and see the last cove in this part of Caprera, which, moreover, is also the most sheltered one of all. And that's Porto Palma. Let's go see Porto Palma.
Palma. Andiamo a vedere Porto Palma.
We've reached the end of the day. We've seen three bays. But on the first day of sailing, you'll probably not be able to see them all, because if you leave in the afternoon from Cala de Sardi, it will take you almost 2 hours to get here. So on the first day, you can go to one roadstead. But we've shown you three, and now we're showing you a fourth, so that you can choose the one that will be your destination on the first day. We're now in Porto Palma. Porto Palma is important because it's one of the most protected bays in the Maddalena Archipelago. Here we are, perfectly sheltered from all the northerly winds. Right, Simona?
Yes, that's right. We are south of Caprera, so the bay is protected from all but southerly winds. But as you see, the mainland of Sardinia is really close to this island.
So the fetch is very short.
Exactly. The depth of this bay is very shallow. This, together with its width, is its characteristic. The depth ranges from 4 meters near the coast to 8 meters right in the middle of the bay. The bottom is a mixture of sand and seaweed and is a good holder, but be careful when giving anchor. Go backwards and make sure the anchor has dug in, because otherwise you might risk tripping the anchor because of the seaweed.
This is because part of the bay is mud. Pretty hard mud, but we also have mooring fields.
Yes, we have the mooring fields. The ones of the park have yellow buoys, not to be confused with the orange ones behind us, which belong to Caprera Sailing Club instead.
This is also the home of Centro Velico Caprera, one of the best-known sailing schools in Italy. It opened in 1967, in the footsteps of the Glenans Sailing School, which is still considered one of the best schools in the world. They're very well organized. They have both cabin cruisers and many dinghies. One special feature that they're very proud of is that they have no professional instructors. All of their instructors are alumni of the school. They include professionals, entrepreneurs, even doctors who decide once a year to dedicate 2, 3, or even 4 weeks to serve as instructors here at Caprera Sailing Center. Having said that, how about we call this a day? We'll go and prepare our dinner and relax a bit. But we'll see you again tomorrow for another day's itinerary, with many more surprises in store. See you tomorrow, then.
A domani.
It's been a long day. We need to rest a little.
I agree.
Listen, earlier I heard you talking on the phone in English. You speak it very well.
Thank you. It's actually among the first things they asked me when I applied to NSS, because for them it's essential we know English very well as a second language, and then possibly another foreign language as well.
Yes, it is true. They actually want all their crews to speak some other languages so that they can work with their foreign clientele.
Yes. What other language do you speak?
I speak English. I lived abroad for a couple of years between Australia and New Zealand, but I also speak Spanish.
I speak German besides English. I think it can be an important language to use in this area of work.
Yes, there are many German tourists. I think our break will be short-lived, though. We have to think about our Italian guests.
I agree.
Day two of our week in the Maddalena Archipelago. We left this morning from Porto Palma and arrived here on the island of Santo Stefano at Cala Villa Marina. From here, we continued on. We did Cala Granara on the island of Sparghi. Then we went to the island of Budelli, and we'll start our talk from there, from the island of Budelli. Would you describe what you saw in Budelli?
Yes. We were at Cala Coccodrillo, or Crocodile Cove, exactly on the eastern side of the island. A bay perfectly sheltered from the northwest and west, even when the wind is very strong, with a depth ranging from 3 to 15 meters. The sandy bottom is closer to the beach, with more rocks and seagrass as you move away. This is the closest point to the famous Spiaggia Rosa, the Pink Beach. If you want to visit the Pink Beach, you can go ashore with a tender. There is a small headland dividing this cove from the beach. Stay on the headland. Do not go further, because the beach is a natural reserve and cannot be accessed.
Perfect. From Budelli, on this journey of ours, we arrived on the island of Sparghi, and we went to visit Cala Granara, a fantastic natural spot. Can you give us some information on Cala Granara?
Cala Granara is also very beautiful, with classic colors of the archipelago, as previously in Budelli. Cala Granara has a depth ranging from 3 to 15 to 20 meters, with an entirely sandy bottom. The cove is protected from the west to the north, even when the wind is strong. Due to its beautiful colors, Cala Granara, like Budelli, is visited by many boats. So be aware that in peak season, there will be many people. But the amazing color of the water alone is worth the stop.
And in Cala Granara, you'll find a surprise. Wild boars. There are many wild boars that often stroll peacefully on the beach, and we saw one of them. We leave Cala Granara and return to our starting point, the first cove we saw this morning, Villa Marina. A peculiar cove because, unlike Sparghi and Budelli, there are never many boats here, simply because it lacks that emerald green water. We show it to you because the day you're tired of being among dozens of boats, this is a place where you can come and find some peace and privacy. Can you give us some information on Cala Villa Marina?
The bay faces south, sheltered from all winds. It is only open to the south, but even then, the fetch here will be minimal, due to the presence of Sardinia right in front of us. Be careful when entering and exiting. Always stay well in the center due to the presence of rocks, some of which are close to the surface right at the entrance of the bay. Inside the center, we have a depth of about 15 meters, and on the two sides, about 2 to 3 meters. The bottom is mixed sand and mud, the same as we saw in Porto Palma, which is why the color of the water here is not emerald, but a little darker. The seabed is still a good holder, but if you decide to swing at anchor, stay in the center. If you go to the sides, especially if you stay the night, put a line ashore.
Around the entire cove, you'll find rings embedded in the rocks. They can help you secure a line ashore. The rings were once used to moor ships going into the granite quarry. When you go ashore with your tender, you'll find a pier. If you want, you can use it for mooring. Ashore, you can walk down a path that's found on the right for about 100 meters. You'll come to a square where you'll find a huge statue in three pieces. It's a statue that, when finished, should have been 13 meters high. There's half a bust with a sailor's hat. It's the bust of Costanzo Ciano, the father of Galeazzo Ciano, a very important figure in the fascist regime. When he died, they wanted to make a big statue of him. But on July 25, 1943, Benito Mussolini's government resigned, and the next day, they stopped working. After Cala Villa Marina, we proceed to the port of Cala Gravetta, where our second day in the Maddalena ends. Let's go. Good morning. Today is the third day of our itinerary. But as you can see, unfortunately, the weather isn't very good. There are almost 40 knots of wind outside, and especially in the sky, there's no sun. They're just clouds. What do you do on days like these when you're on a boat? One of the things you can do is stop and visit things on land. We're going to do just that today, choosing two things to see ashore. The first is a visit to the town of La Maddalena. Shall we go? I don't remember the town being so nice.
Not only is it very pretty, but it is also very well maintained and also peaceful. For tourists, there is a main street and a few alleys.
Right, a couple of squares, not much else.
But you can find everything from typical small stores, local handicrafts, and of course the pharmacies and the post office.
And also many restaurants.
Those are never lacking, restaurants and bars.
There must be a lot of hustle and bustle here in the evening, with all these places where you can eat and drink. I saw that there are also two ports.
Yes, one where we are moored, which is Cala Gaveta. This one in front of us, and the other one behind us at the end of this road, Cala Mangiavolpe. In Cala Gaveta, we have a concrete jetty, while in the other ones, we have two floating jetties.
Certamente.
And there's a gas station, plus electricity and water for each berth.
Maurizio, shall we tell our viewers about that second dock that has been added to Cala Gaveta?
Of course we should.
Yes, in August 2021, they opened Cala Balbiani, which is located just before the entrance to Cala Gaveta.
And now, the two bays together, managed by the municipality of La Maddalena, can offer as many as 140 berths. After seeing the village of Maddalena with its little alleys and old buildings, which are very nice, if we still have time, and we still have to stay at the dock because of the weather, another thing we can do is take a cab and go to the island of Caprera. Yes, by cab. Between Caprera and Maddalena, there's a bridge that connects them. So we'll go to Caprera and visit the White House, the house where Giuseppe Garibaldi lived for a good 26 years, and where he died. It's a very nice place, very interesting, and the house is still as it was in 1882, when the hero of two worlds died. There's his furniture, his wheelchairs, his uniforms, so many things that are part of Giuseppe Garibaldi's life. There's his tomb, but most of all, there are his boats. Interesting to see a boat that started out as a rowboat, and then Garibaldi modified it into a sailboat, because he didn't want to go to sea with other people. He wanted to be alone, and he wanted to understand how to sail, because Giuseppe Garibaldi, before anything else, was a great sailor.
Era un grande marinaio.
When the wind dropped below 40 knots and settled around 28 or 29 knots, we left Cala Gaveta, went up the island of La Maddalena, and arrived here in the north of the island, at Cala Spalmatore, a cove really very well protected from the west wind. In fact, as you can see, the cove is perfectly quiet when it's really very windy outside. When we arrived, we were met by Michela and Armando, who are two people who run the mooring field in the Cala Spalmatore, a field with 18 buoys, and they helped us by letting us attach a buoy at the bow and a buoy at the stern of our catamaran. So we're perfectly safe. Now Simona will give us some practical information on Cala Spalmatore.
We are located in the northeast of the island of La Maddalena. This bay is quite wide. However, by a local ordinance, you cannot anchor. So your only possibility is to get one of the 18 buoys that can moor boats up to 60 meters, so even very large ones. The service is very good. If you come with a catamaran, they also put a buoy at the stern in addition to one at the bow, while sailboats instead swing around.
The service, as Simona said, is great. They can even supply you with water. They extend a hose from the wharf, come here with a dinghy, and fill your water tanks. But not only that. If you want, you can call them and they'll do your shopping for you. Order what you want. When you arrive, you'll have the provisions ready to be loaded on board. And last but not least, one thing that's really essential in this area, garbage disposal.
Yes, exactly. Because there are very few places where you can leave garbage, in reality it's only here at La Maddalena. So, in addition to the three docks that we saw at the port that we left this afternoon, here is another place where it's possible to leave it.
Now we're going to go ashore and eat at a very nice farmhouse that's a few hundred meters from here. And tomorrow morning, we'll tell you all about it.
Simona, we are tanked up.
Perfect. Thank you.
One question. Have you been going around with the Solovela.net crew for a long time?
No, it's been about a year or so. We've already done 6 or 7 videos together. And they call me every time they have to do a video with NSS, because they know I collaborate well with them.
Does Solovela.net only rely on NSS charter?
No, not only to them. But Maurizio really likes working with NSS. He says they are very well organized, which is true. And they provide him with everything he needs, whenever he needs to do something.
I can see that because I also get along with NSS. Anyway, I'm going to prepare an aperitif for the guests who are coming. Will I see
Absolutely.
You later?
Absolutely.
The fourth day of our itinerary begins with strong winds. Not that the other days it was weak. We always had between 22 and 35 knots, but today, already in the morning, we're around 40 knots. So it promises to be a very windy day. The wind is turned from the east to the north. Fortunately, in Cala Spalmatore, things are very calm, so we're able to stay at the buoy without much trouble. Last night, as we told you, we went to eat nearby, 300 meters from Cala Spalmatore. Actually, it wasn't a farmhouse, as I had told you. It's a restaurant called L'Agriturismo. That is, the farmhouse. What counts is that we ate pretty well. But the really remarkable thing was the porchetto, a piggy, perfectly cooked Sardinia style, and really good. Try it. Now we're going to try to sail out of Cala Spalmatore. The cool thing about this area is that even with so much wind, there are never big waves. Even today, there'll be a meter, 1, 20 tops, and less when you find a shelter behind an island. So let's go out and see if we can find any sheltered bays to show you again on this fourth day.
Seguitemi.
We finished our fourth day of the itinerary, and as we announced this morning, we went to see some bays. We visited 3, which we'll tell you about now. But before I do, I want to remind you that to get more information beyond what you can find in this video, and to review the information Simona gave on each bay, you can go download our article, The Maddalena Notebook. The link is in the description page below the YouTube video, or in the first featured comment. Do it, because it's very useful if you plan to come and see the Maddalena Archipelago. And now, we go to see our bays. The first one we saw is a really exceptional bay, which actually is not really a bay, but a body of water enclosed between 3 islands, Rizzoli, Santa Maria, and Budelli, which people call the Piscine, or the Pools. It's a place that will definitely amaze you because of the color of the water. Simona, do you want to tell us about the pools?
Yes. At the center of these 3 islands, this bay is actually called Manto della Madonna, but everyone knows it as the Pools, for this emerald water that you find here. At the Pools, we have a depth ranging from 2 to 10 meters in the middle of the bay. It is exposed only to westerly winds. The bottom is a mix of sand and grass. But if you look, you will find a sandy spot, because there are many of them. Wherever the water is emerald, there will be sand. Go there. It is a beautiful place. But be aware that it is very busy, so you will never be alone. Maybe at night, after sunset, there will be some peace.
Also remember that this stretch of water is really very close to Budelli. And in Budelli, as we saw the other day, there's a park buoy field, so you can also use the buoys that are there. Leaving the piscine after a few minutes of sailing, we arrive on the west side of Rizzoli, one of the three islands surrounding the piscine, and where we find Cala Lunga, another really special bay. Simona, Cala Lunga.
A very beautiful place. Inside, it is an entirely rocky cove. The atmosphere inside the bay is really special and powerful. I hope you like it as much as I did. We have a depth inside ranging from 5 to 10 meters. Again, it's a mixed bottom with sand and weed. Look for sandy spots if possible. It is open naturally to the east and southeast and sheltered from the rest.
And so we also visited Cala Lunga, another place definitely worth seeing. Here in the archipelago, you'll be spoiled for choice among all the places to see each day. So don't try to see them all. From Cala Lunga, we head to the open sea again and off to the eastern side of the island of Sparghi, where we find Cala Conneri, another very interesting place, where it will be very pleasant for you to spend the night. Unfortunately, not for us who had to come back here. Shall we talk about Cala Conneri?
Yes. This is also a very beautiful bay. In the middle, it has a small promontory that divides the bay in two. So in fact, there are two bays, but the characteristics are the same. The only difference is that in the northern bay, you don't find sand on the beach, only stones, while in the southern one, the beach is sandy, and it is possible to go ashore. It is perfectly protected and an excellent shelter for strong northwesterly and westerly winds, so you will be safe. It has a sandy bottom near the beach, then rocky as you move away, with a depth ranging from about 3 meters to 20 meters, depending on how far away you anchor. It has very blue water, beautiful, the classic water of the archipelago being in Sparghi. You will also find several boats, perhaps just passing through. However, the bay and its colors are worth the stop.
After Cala Conneri, we returned to La Maddalena. After 3 days of very strong wind tonight, we expect some undertow, so we preferred not to stay at the roadstead, but to come here, to Cala Mangiavolpi. The other day, we took you to Cala Gavetta, which is definitely a more sheltered place. With the fourth day over, we'll see you tomorrow morning to start the fifth day of our itinerary. As we predicted in the beginning of the video, we had a week in which it was definitely not easy to do the kind of work we're doing. There were days when it was totally cloudy, so we couldn't shoot, and a wind ranging from 25 to 40 knots. Today, on the other hand, it feels like the first day of full summer. Absolutely clear skies. The wind has dropped to 20 knots. The sea, unfortunately, still rough, because in the past few days, there's really been a lot of wind. But here it is. Look what a day we have. And on this day, we made another tour to show you three more roadsteads. We started this morning with the island of Sparghi, where we went to see Cala Corsara, a really very beautiful bay that our skipper will now tell you about. Simona, you're up.
Simona, a te.
We are in the southeast of the island of Sparghi, a very large bay with no less than 4 small beaches. Watch out for 2 rocks in the bay. One a little bit to the south, very clearly visible, and the other one at the water's edge, a little bit to the north, which is close to the line of buoys that signals the no-access area in front of the beach. It's a bay with beautiful water, the classic blue of the archipelago, with a depth ranging from about 3 to 10 meters. It has a mostly sandy bottom, and we are sheltered from all northern winds.
We leave Cala Corsara and return to La Maddalena, north near Cala Spalmatori, where we stayed the other day, and here we find Cala Stagno Torto. It's not among the most beautiful bays we visited, but it has a peculiarity. It's sheltered from all southerly winds. Today, we want to show you a couple of bays that are protected from those winds, bays that in the past days we couldn't show you. It can always come in handy in case you come here and find southerly winds to know a bay where you can go to take shelter. So Stagno Torto sheltered us from the southerly winds. Simona.
Stagno Torto is a very large bay, so it can provide shelter for several boats. Beware of some rocks inside the bay. Some are visible, others below the water surface are not. And most importantly, they are not marked in Navionics. So be careful, especially if you arrive in this bay at night. The seabed is between 3 and 10 to 12 meters and is a mixture of sand, seaweed and rocks. We are well sheltered from the southerly and easterly winds here. It can be a good alternative when all the other bays are very crowded. At least it is peaceful. If you want, there is also a jetty so you can go ashore. A beach equipped with umbrellas and deck chairs, and a bar that is open in season. Now it is closed. The road from here leads you first to Porto Massimo and then to the village of La Maddalena.
We leave Stagno Torto and head on to Caprera and arrive in this really very beautiful bay. This is also sheltered from the east and it's called Cala Napolitana. Can you tell us about Cala Napolitana?
We came from the island of La Maddalena, so we had no problems. But if by chance you are coming from south of Caprera and you are coasting going north, watch out for a dangerous shoal that you will find just nearby. Do not pass between the shoal and the shore. The Navionics say give 3 meters, but go wide, which is much safer. Once inside the bay, we are well sheltered from all easterly winds. We have a depth ranging from 2.5 meters to 10 to 12 meters, with a mostly sandy bottom. It's a very pretty bay.
Really, very beautiful. One peculiarity, when we arrived today, we came from the north. We came to this area and we thought that the bay was not very sheltered. It didn't give us that impression, but as we rounded this headland, we found instead an absolutely sheltered place. With this, we end our fifth day. We're going to take a break and get ready for the night. We'll see you tomorrow for the last day, when we'll return to Cala de Sarde. But before we reach our final destination, we'll stop for one last bay. We've just returned to Cala de Sarde. On the trip from the Maddalena Archipelago to Cala de Sarde, we wanted to stop for one last swim, and we chose the VIP bay, the one where you find lots of mega yachts, a bay that's less than a 10-minute boat ride from here, Cala di Volpi. So Simona, for the last time and the last bay, be patient and tell us about Cala di Volpi.
We are, of course, in the northeast of Sardinia, in a very large bay, open only to southerly winds. It is shallow. In the center of the bay, the maximum depth is only 15 meters, and much less as you get closer to the sides. There is a mixed sand and seaweed bottom, and lots of buoys for the super yachts. So in season, it will definitely not be the quietest place, because there will be a coming and going of dinghies, maybe jet skis and water skis. However, for one last swim, it is ideal.
Very good. And with that, we've definitely concluded our itinerary in the Maddalena Archipelago. I hope you enjoyed and found out some interesting stuff. If so, let us know. Give us your like. Remember that if you want to get a whole range of technical information, such as the phone number of the mechanic, the refrigerator man, the buoy field with Armando and Michela, whom we met in La Maddalena, download the Maddalena Notebook. The article you can find with the link in the description below the video itself, or in the first featured comment, the first in the whole series of comments. Do so, because it's a very interesting article. I thank Simona for her great patience and professional skill. I also thank NSS Charter, because they're the ones who made this video possible by providing us with the boats and the people we needed to sail them. All that remains is for me to give you an appointment to the next video of svnsolovela.net.